Thank you for being here. I want you to turn to Acts chapter 5. This is our last investigation in this particular paragraph and passage. We're going to begin reading at verse 17 and read down through verse 21. Acts chapter 5, verse 17. We've been dealing with this for some weeks, and we're looking again at verse 21. I want to give you one more idea, one more concept as we end out this paragraph. Well, next Sunday, we'll be going into the Sermon on the Mount again. So what we do, our pattern is, we do a paragraph in Acts, we do a paragraph in Matthew. And so we'll be going back to Matthew, dealing with the fasting idea, which is given in chapter 6. And we're ready to go down to, I think it's verse 16, and work our way down through verse 18. There's just about two verses of it or so. And it's an interesting passage. Yes, it goes from verse 16 down through verse 18. So we'll be spending at least six studies on that idea of fasting, which is really the idea of spiritual disciplines. Oh, man, I hate discipline. Makes me want to wash my mouth out with soap. Discipline is nasty, isn't it? Just to think about discipline. Oh, man. So get your teeth and bear it. Come on. But we're going to be talking about that. Jesus puts a whole new slant on it. Oh, it's great. I can hardly wait. Okay, back to Acts chapter 5. Reading verse 17. It says, "Then the high priest rose up, and all of those who were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees. And they were filled with indignation. They laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. But at night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, 'Go stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this life.' And when they heard that, they entered the temple early in the morning and taught. But the high priest and those with him came and called the council together with all the elders of the children of Israel and sent to the prison to have them brought." Let's pray together. You're amazing, Jesus. And I guess the reason we've gathered and what we really are asking you for this morning is for you to manifest, display, impress upon us that immensity and greatness of your personhood. Could we see you today? And I know that in seeing you, we'll see ourselves. And I know that in seeing you, we'll see our circumstances as they really are. And I know in seeing you, we will somehow, some way, see a way through all of this, because you are the way, the truth, and the life. So again, we're asking for a revelation of yourself. And Lord, you know every single one of us, and you know how we think, and you know what it would take to manifest yourself to us, what it would take for you to reveal yourself in us. And whatever that takes, whatever you have to do that, whatever walls you have to break down, whatever concepts you have to set aside, whatever obstacles you have to overcome in our lives to bring us into the fullness of your presence and personhood, do it today. We love you. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Faithfulness is an attribute that everybody applauds. Everybody thinks it's good. We all want to have it. We all try to achieve it. Faithfulness. If you go to the dictionary and look up the word faithfulness, there's other words that can be used for it. One is the idea of loyalty, of course, steadfastness, that kind of idea. And consistency is a part of faithfulness. If you take that and bring it into the job, your job, the guy who's faithful in his job is the guy who always shows up. He's there on time. He works. He gets his hands dirty. He gets in the middle of everything. He never holds back. He's a faithful, and he's done that for decades. And we look at him and say, he is faithful. Consistent, steadfast. You get the idea. If you take that concept and you bring it into marriage, of course, the guy who is faithful in marriage is the guy who's faithful to his wife, never has had an affair, doesn't cheat on her, has been a constant help and building in the family. He's the faithful father, faithful, steadfast, loyal. See, that's something to be applauded. There's no doubt about that. You can either take that word, we do at least, take that word and we apply it to objects. For instance, I have a faithful Dodge truck. Which means it always starts, not like a Ford. It always is faithful. You can count on it in cold weather. You can count it on in hot weather. It's a faithful Dodge truck. Amen. Thank you. I knew there was one someplace. So, see, you can put it to objects as well. So this faithful idea, this consistent idea. But the interesting thing to me is that when you come to the Bible, the faithful idea is consistently and constantly, faithfully, focused on God. We appear not to be too faithful. But biblically, God, think about it, is always faithful. He is consistent. He is loyal. He is constant. He is steadfast. God is faithful. One of our favorite scriptures for that is Hebrews 8:13. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Meaning what? It means what he was yesterday, whatever you figured out he was yesterday. What do you read about him in the scriptures? He is that same identical thing today. Whatever was going on in Jesus in the scriptures, in the gospel accounts, the way he treated people, his death, his pouring his life out, his desire to redeem, his love, all of that, all that's contained in that is the same identical way he is now. And he's going to be that way forever. Through these years, I have definitely rebelled against the idea that Jesus is faithful and loving and kind and gentle and wanting to forgive and merciful now, but he's coming back mean and nasty, and he's going to get you and judge you. That's not biblical, folks. Whatever he is in the gospel account, whatever loving Jesus you see in the dying on a cross, whatever's going on here in the gospel account, that he is that same way when he comes back. He does not change. Do you know how important that is? See, if you have a God that is fickle, wow. Will he forgive me? Well, maybe, maybe not. If you get on his good side, if he has a good day, if his circumstances are okay. See, when will he not? He got up on the wrong, our God got up on the wrong side of the day. Well, the wrong side of the bed today. See, if you've got that kind of God, you're in trouble. Which is why the Bible hounds, absolutely hounds, I mean goes after it, this idea to impress upon you that our God, our Trinity God, our Jesus is absolutely consistent, constant, always the same, faithful, never alters. Circumstances don't upset him. When things are going well, he's one way. When things aren't going well, he's another. No, he's the same both times because he exists above the circumstances and he is just plain flat down to it, consistent. The Old Testament is full of this. Let me read you one. For he is the living God and steadfast forever. Woo! Isn't that good news? Did you get it? He is the living God and steadfast forever. His kingdom is the one which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall endure to the end. He is the living God and steadfast forever. In fact, the scripture says this, which is amazing. That all of that steadfastness and faithfulness of God spills into his words. So that what I've got in my hand is faithful, steadfast, and sure to the end. In fact, Jesus said, not one dot, not one iota, not one shall pass away to all. Will be fulfilled because it is faithfully the words. The Bible says this, your testimonies, word, which you have commanded are righteous and very, very faithful. Paul was writing to Timothy and said, Timothy, come on, Timothy, if we are faithless, which we are, if we are faithless, he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself. Meaning what? Well, it's just who he is. He can't go against his nature. He can't go against the grain of his system. It's impossible for God not to be faithful. Why? Well, it burns in his bones. It's all over his character. It's the way he thinks. To do something opposite of being consistent and faithful would be to go against the very essence of who God is, because this is our God. He is faithful. You got it? Now, we talk a lot about this idea of merger. In other words, the whole New Testament is set up on the basis that Jesus died for us, forgive us our sins, so he could invade our flesh. So we're always talking about the idea that our helplessness, who we are, which is nothing, this is not a law structure, this is not pull it off, this is not a deed to get done, this is not something to accomplish, oh, I ought to be faithful, okay, I'll bite my lip and try, I'll try to discipline myself. That's not what we're dealing with. What we're dealing with is the very nature of God, which is faithful, literally indwelling me. Which would mean what? I would become faithful. And all the time, it wouldn't be me. It would be this merger between who I am and who he is, because I can't pull this off. But he, indwelling me, would literally pull this together, and there would begin to emanate out of my life, spill out of my life, the wonder of his faithfulness. Wouldn't that be something? In fact, listen to this. Paul said, continue in the faith, grounded and steadfast, and not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which you heard. Come on. Dig it in deep. Steadfast. Grounded. How is that possible? Oh, it's interesting. The fruit of the Spirit. Fruit means I'm not responsible for it. I give birth to it. I'm the instrument. I'm the tree from which the fruit is born. I bear the fruit. And what's the fruit of the Spirit? Fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. So how am I going to find faithfulness in my life, consistency in my life? Aren't you tired of the up and down, in and out? Wasn't. Just sick of that. Wouldn't it be something to, one Bible scholar said, I'm not on the mountain. I'm not in the valley. I'm on the way. Woo, there's a consistency in that, see. I'm not up, I'm not down, I'm just, wouldn't that be great? How's that going to take place? Fruit of the Spirit. Somehow, who God is in his faithfulness is going to indwell me. And through me, that faithfulness will begin to guide, permeate my life. Now, I've discovered there's a difference between stubbornness. I've got that one down. There's a difference between stubbornness and faithfulness. And that probably ought to be clear in our minds. See, stubbornness is closed down. Stubbornness is narrow-minded. Stubbornness is, hey, I don't care. I'm not going to. Stubbornness has the idea of spit in your face, man. Stubbornness has the idea of, I don't care what you say. Stubbornness is not open to new thoughts. Faithfulness. See, that's a different ball game. Because faithfulness is, okay, we really need to discuss that. and understand that. God is faithful, not stubborn. Hang on to that. One thing happens when you get into the scriptures is you discover, now think about this, you discover that God's faithfulness, his consistency, his loyalty is all focused on one thing. Does God do other things? I don't know. There is a possibility. God is bigger than we are. So he may have a lot of things going on that I don't know about. That's very, very possible. The scriptures is very narrow. So we only know a part. Did God create other universes, other places? Beats me. Doesn't say. See, all of this is focused. The scriptures is focused. Does God take Friday night off and go bowling in a big bowling alley of the sky? Possibility. I don't know. Doesn't say so. Maybe he has outside interests. Maybe he has hobbies. We don't know. But it's biblically what you've got going is God has one thing. He is desperately loyal, consistent, and faithful to. And that's the redeeming you. God has attached himself to you, and he won't turn loose. God is so fixated on you that he has to have you. There is a consistency and a faithfulness in that, that he wants to redeem you. And it's not mankind. Get this. It's not mankind, biblically. You can't say, well, he just wants to redeem the whole world. Yeah, okay. But it's the whole world made up of you, 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 and you. And when you come to the heart of the scriptures, it is an individual kind of thing. And we've talked about this, that God was back before I was born, literally mixing my substance, that he's been involved in your life. And you are not just a number on a board, not just an number in the statistics of the county. You are, wow. He is locked in and has this faithfulness to you. We are always using the word around here, prevenient grace, which is phenomenal. And I want to use it so often that you get tired of it, of the word. Prevenient grace is the grace of God that goes before. Prevenient means going before. It's the grace of God that goes before. Before what? Before you ever encounter him personally. Before you ever get saved, before you ever experience his forgiveness in your life, God has been actively moving in your direction, actively involved, manipulating the circumstances of your life. We love to use illustrations like he moves a Christian in next door to me. Can you believe it? They play their Christian music loud, blaring it all over. I just get sick of hearing it. I'm going down to my job. Good night. They hired one down there too. Oh, they're everywhere. See, God is just after you. He's the hound of heaven just chasing you down. He just cannot. See, that is all over the scriptures, people, that he is faithfully after your life. And he just won't quit. Suppose I spit in his face. He wipes it off and keeps coming. Do people go to hell? Yes, they do. But they have to walk through his blood. They have to stomp over his person. They have to kick him in the face to do it. And he's yelling at them all the way. That's faithfulness, isn't it? Woo! And do you realize that's our God? That's the faithfulness of our God, who is locked in on one specific thing, one focus, the redemption of your life. He wants you. Wow, that's phenomenal. Now, all of that is an introduction to the passage. Look at the passage. Now, what's happened, of course, is that the high priest and the Sadducees have got all bent out of shape. Again, they've stayed bent out of shape. But finally, it's reached a peak. They can't stand it anymore. They grab a hold of all the apostles, throw them in jail. And then, the next morning, they got up, came down to their special council room, called the council together, and said, go get the apostles out of jail. But when they went down to the jail, lo and behold, an angel had come that night and had let the apostles out of jail, and they did not escape in terms of running away and hiding. He told them, go stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this life. And they did. When they heard that, verse 21, and when they heard that, they entered the temple early in the morning and they taught. But the high priest and those with him came and called the council together. So over here on this side, you got the council being called together. Over here on this side, you've got the apostles out of jail now by the power of God. And they've gone down to the temple as they were instructed, and they are now teaching in the temple. Interesting scene. I want to break it down for you. Number one, concept. He's giving us a concept here. Man, I want you to get this. There are two main verbs in the beginning of verse 21. When they heard that, they entered the temple early in the morning and taught. The two main verbs are entered and taught. Now, entered is the idea. I don't even need to explain that to you, but it's in the indicative in the Greek language. I'm trying to impress you. It's in the indicative in the Greek language, which means it's statement of fact. In other words, he's not arguing. He's not, well, maybe. Well, I think they did. No, they snuck in the... No, he said, they entered into the temple. Plain, flat, statement of fact. No argument. There they are. You saw them enter. That's done. The other verb, which is taught, entered, taught, is the teaching idea, obviously. It's the preaching idea. And, of course, all of their teaching and preaching was focused on the person of Jesus. But the impressive thing about it is it's in the imperfect tense, which means that something happened in the past. It's continuing into the present. It's continuing into the present, and it doesn't look like it's going to end in the future. So they began to teach. Not they taught now. They haven't been teaching, but they taught. No, they've been teaching. They're continuing to teach, and it doesn't look like they're going to quit teaching. So there is a consistency, a faithfulness in their proclamation of the person of Jesus Christ. Isn't that amazing? Now, back up with me to the first persecution. We're dealing here with the second persecution. We've gone over this. But let me do it again. The lame beggar, he's by the gate, beautiful. Peter and John come along, grab him by the hand. And a miracle takes place, and the whole temple goes berserk. Everybody's talking about it because they all know him. He's been there. He's over 40 years of age. He's been there all these years begging, and this guy is running around like a wild man. And the whole temple goes crazy, and they all gather around Peter and John and in the temple, and Peter begins to preach. And he, as he preaches, of course, this group that we're dealing with, the Sanhedrin, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, are all bent out of shape about this. They run in, shut him down, and the first persecution takes place. They take Peter and John, just the two of them, put them in jail, leave them there all night, get them out the next morning, they interrogate them. And they can't do anything about it because the miracle is so obvious they cannot deny it because everybody says, we see it. The guy's running all around. He's standing right there. What are you going to do? They can't do anything about it, so they can't refute it. And so they have to do something else. And they can't punish the Peter and John because they're so popular over the miracle. So they threaten them. And this all takes place in chapter 4. They threatened them and said, do not teach and do not preach and don't ever mention the name of Jesus ever, ever, ever again. That's their threat. Now, if you go, they came then, they turned them loose. Peter and John came back to the early church. And when they came back to the early church, he told them everything, that we're all going to die, guys. They're going to kill us all if we talk about Jesus again. So you know what they did? Oh, look at verse chapter 4, verse 29. It says, in this prayer, here's what they prayed. Now, Lord, look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness we may speak your word. That was their prayer. Don't let us back up. What we've been doing, we want to continue to do now, and we want to continue it in the future. Don't let us, give us boldness, oh God, to be faithful, consistent, to stick with it. Was their prayer answered? Well, you go to verse 31. And when they prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. So their prayer was answered. And they continued faithfully, consistently speaking and proclaiming about Jesus. Amazing. Now, as they did that, the church began to grow again. And lo and behold, the second persecution shows up, which is what we're dealing with in this chapter. And isn't it interesting that in this chapter, we get the same identical thing? They've threatened them, threw them in jail. And what did the angel do? Got them out and said, go stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this. So continue, be faithful. What you've been doing, continue to do. What you're continuing to do, stay with it. Don't bend, don't give in. Be faithful, stay with this. So would you not agree with me that the apostles are faithful? Now, understand this. It's not that they're faithful to preaching. And I suppose the reason I'm bringing that up is because that's an issue with me. Because it was an issue in my life. See, ministry can become a career. Like any job. So you become faithful to your job. And when preaching becomes a job, then I'm off-centered. Because see, the focus was not on their preaching. The focus was not on their teaching. The focus was not on the church. Well, I'm faithful to the church. I don't care. I faithfully give my money. I care. No, I don't care about that either. I don't care. Why? Because that's not the focus. See, we are not money-driven, we are not career-driven, we are not preaching-driven. Well, what is their focus? Jesus-driven. And there is a difference. See, if I'm preaching-driven, oh, I got cancer of the throat, I'll never speak again. So preaching is over. Well, what are you going to do now? Well, I'm not preaching-centered, I'm Jesus-centered. So I'm going to get a board, I'm going to write it out so you have to read it. What if both of my hands fall off? I get them cut off and I can't write. Then I'm going to stand at Walmart with gospel tracts in my teeth and pass them out. See, I'm going to find a way. Why? Because this is not about preaching. Do you get this? This is not about teaching. This is about Jesus burns in my bones. Jesus, see, this is not about I'm loyal to the church. I promise you, if you are faithful to the church, you will get mad and quit. Because we won't treat you right, because we're mean. Hey, somebody will do something. Why? Because we got hypocrites here. So if you're loyal, faithful, consistent to the church, and it's based on that, you'll get discouraged and give up. Guys, this is not about that. This is about Jesus, the wonder of the person of Jesus. This is about their focus was on Jesus. See, the whole threat was, don't talk about Jesus. It wasn't don't go to church. It wasn't don't do miracles. Don't talk about Jesus. See, it wasn't about don't have parties. Don't talk about Jesus. It wasn't don't meet in your houses and eat. It was don't talk about Jesus. The whole deal was their faithfulness and consistency to Jesus. Let me show you how strong this is. The angel here got Peter out of jail and the other apostles and told them, go back down into the temple and preach. Don't run away. Stay where you are. Well, they'll get us again. Doesn't matter. Go back. Be faithful. Stand in the temple. Preach all the words of this life. They did. But do you know, Peter got in jail again in chapter 12 of Acts. They put him in jail again. When he got out that time, you know what he did? Ran off to Caesarea. Wow. Should have gone down to the temple and preached. That's what the angel said. No, this is not about preaching. See, this time we do this. This time we do that. Why? Because we're open. Because we're not focused on preaching. We're focused on Jesus. That is contrasted, you note, in verse 21, with the high priest. So here's a group of apostles who are focused on Jesus. But the high priest and those with him came and called the council together with all the elders of the children of Israel and sent to the prison to have them brought out. What are they focused on? Themselves. Now let's go back to the first persecution. How did these guys, this Sanhedrin, handle the first persecution? Well, I want you to look at it in chapter 4. It's very revealing. In chapter 4, it says in verse 15, but when they had commanded, they brought them out of jail. Peter and John are in jail, been there all night. They brought them out. But when they had commanded them to go outside of the council, they conferred among themselves. Do you know what that means? That means they had a big oak table and they all gathered around the big oak table and they all put their heads together and said, what do you think? This is what I think. And they came up to a decision. Now you got the same thing going on in chapter 5 in verse 21. But the high priest and those with him came and called the council together. Come on, guys, let's get together. And we call this meeting and we all put our heads together. They turned in. You know what the apostles did? They turned out. See, a focus on, you got to get this. A focus on Jesus is always a, oh. See, I wondered why I always react the same way. Did you ever think about that? See, you do something to me, I always react the same way. I'm consistent. I'm faithful. You know why? Because when certain things happen, I always turn in. And my insides say, this is the way to react. And I do. Well, how am I going to change my actions? I've got to quit turning inside. And I got to turn out to him. Think about it. See, you slap me upside the head. I turn in, and my insides say, hit him back. How am I going to get over losing my temper? How am I going to get over that? As long as I turn in, I'm always going, oh. How am I going to get over that? I've got to not turn in and confer with myself. I've got to turn to him and say, what do you think? See, circumstances come to my life. I turn in, and my insides say, get drunk. How am I going to get over that? I'm going to have to turn out and say, Jesus, here's the circumstance. How do I handle it? See, something is disastrous. Something takes place. Pressure comes to my life. I turn in. Pop a pill. How can I get over that? I've got to turn out to him. See, the object of what you focus on, of your faithfulness, really matters. And the reason I do what I always do and I always end up in the same spot is because I turn in. They did that every time. Every time they're confronted with the gospel, they turn in. Here's a guy who's in a worship service. He's a teenager. God speaks to him. He knows he ought to respond and give his life to Christ and even come to an altar. And you know what he does? He turns in and he says to himself, well, I'm not ready. I'm young. I'll do it another time. So he shuts it down. Now he's 25. He's in another worship service. Lo and behold, God speaks to him. He should give his life to Jesus. Really come through on this thing. Really surrender like he ought to. He turns in. And you know what it says? You know what he says to himself? Well, I got a lot of living to go. I'm only 25. I'm not ready. I'll wait. So he shuts it down. Now he's 50. He's in a worship service. And God moves upon his life. And you know what happens? He turns in. Says, oh, I'm only 50. I'm not ready. I think I'll wait. And he doesn't respond. Now he's 75 in a worship service. God moves upon his life. He turns in. You know what his inside say? I'm not ready. Maybe next year. And he shuts it down. Now he's 85. Now he's 95. Now he's 110. When is he ever going to turn in and say, yes, I'm ready? Never will. See, he's going to have to break with, oh, because he will faithfully respond the same way when he turns in. Wouldn't it be something not to be filled with yourself, but to be filled with Jesus? And every time you turn in, you see Jesus and he, whoa. That's this passage. So over here's a group of guys that don't turn in, they turn out. Go preach in the temple. And their focus is Jesus. And they are faithful. Over here's a group of guys who are faithful to themselves. Turn in. Here's an interesting statement. It's in John. Jesus was talking to the Pharisees, this group. And he said, you are of your father, the devil. That's strong, isn't it? You are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He, the devil, was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there's no truth in him. And when the devil speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resource, for he is a liar and the father of it. What does that mean? It means that the devil has a big pile right here. This is everything the devil knows. This is all the resource the devil has. Here's everything that's going on in the devil. This is all the resource of the devil right here. And when the devil wants to say something, you know what he does? He reaches into his pile of resource and speaks it. And you know what he speaks? A lie. Why? Because that's all that's in his pile. He always turns in and always speaks a lie because that's all he's full of. See, what he's proposing to us guys is that we need to be faithful, consistent, because our focus is Jesus. You got to get me into this, Jesus. I got to have this. You've got to break every other pattern, all the turning inside, all the things I've established, all the traditions I've set up, all the means I've invented in my life to cope, all the systems that I've designed to survive. You got to help me break with all of that. And you've got to become the single object of my faithfulness. So here we are again, God. You have confronted me with truth. What am I going to do? Don't let me turn in, please, God. Help me. Help me. Show your face to me, God. Let me see your extended hands. Let me sense that you are a faithful God who is for me. You are the faithful high priest who's pleading with the Father in my behalf. You are the faithful witness who's proclaiming to me the truth of yourself. You are the victorious warrior, oh God, whose name is faithful and true. And you're calling me out of myself and all my little pride and all my little selfism and all the ways I've reacted and handled. And you want to develop a whole new structure with yourself in the middle of it, that my life might blossom into the consistency and faithfulness of the heart of God. Give me that today, God. Give me that today. Give me that today. Heads are bowed. It's not easy. Didn't say it was. It's not a breeze. Didn't say it was. To break with yourself. Not turn in, turn out. To Jesus, who's inviting you. And maybe you don't want to go too big with this, that's fine. But would you take one area in your life today? You repeatedly react the same way, do the same thing. Respond in the same manner. How's it going to change? He's giving us the answer. Would you break with that same response and turn to Jesus and see what he does in your life? So our altar is open. Not for the casual, not for the relaxed, not for the odd, it doesn't matter. But for those who want a new object of faithfulness, who want to burn in their bones, not for themselves, but for him. Want to respond? Want to seek with me? I want to kneel. Be obedient in these moments.